Good morning or good day, good evening to everyone. And you are very welcome to GeneXplain web seminar today. And our presenter for today is Dr. Alexander Kiel, who is the Chief Scientific Officer of our company, GeneXplain GmbH. And Alexander Kiel has a great experience in different areas of bioinformatics. And his special interest is in analyzing gene regulatory regions and transcription factors binding sites. And today, Alexander will share with us some of the concepts, ideas, and results and examples. With this, it is my great pleasure to invite Alexander Kiel to start his presentation, please.
Hello, everybody. So I'm sharing my screen now and starting the presentation. So thank you for coming. And today we will talk about non-coding DNA. So non-coding DNA, not non-coding RNA, don't mix up. So looking at these pictures of distribution of known variants, actually SNPs in the human genome, those of them which are actually connected and with different diseases, you see that they cover completely complete genome. And actually the current picture even worse. So this is a recent picture taken from this initiative of mapping the disease-associated mutations to the genome. But the striking fact is that actually almost 95% of those top disease-associated mutations are located in non-coding regions, and only 5% or maybe a bit more is located in the coding regions. But we actually traditionally pay more attention to the coding region mutations because we know the code. We can actually interpret it and we can say something about the reason. And we almost forget the role of the non-coding mutations, and although they are majority of them, 95%. So today I will talk about three things. First, I will try to understand, tell about the principles of gene-regulated code. Then I will come with a couple of examples when these principles are applied in cancer and of course COVID-19. And at the end, I will give some evolutional perspectives and we'll roll out this surrealism of genome concept. We'll wait for that at the end of my talk. So when we talk about these mutations, which are actually coming to the phenotype, there is, for instance, we know the mutation and it leads to a disease. So you see this elephant gets a big ear. So we often forget that this process from mutation to the disease is pretty long. So actually it has intermediate steps, like first through the RNA expression to proteins and then to phenotype. And there is many steps in between. And the first step is understanding how the protein expression is actually encoded in our genome and how those mutations which are happening in the regulatory regions of genes can influence that process. So basically what we know is that there is a genome where we have a little bit of knowledge about how proteins are encoded in a genetic, using genetic code and using some rules how this is can be folded into a functional protein, which is also kind of a question. And recently we got the knowledge that artificial intelligence can do it quite well. But what is doing this protein in the organism is still quite not clear. So basically in which organ or tissue or cell this protein has to express, or in which stage of development, or on which cell cycle phase, under which huge amount of extracellular signal this protein has to express. And all this information, where and when and how this protein has to express, is encoded somewhere in this huge unknown region of genome. If we put an analogy that you have a text in some non-known language, and only part of it is actually we can read, like my name here, still we don't know about this guy pretty a lot. So basically, we don't know where he goes, with whom, when, and so on. And all these actually commands are encoded in this abracadabra text, which we don't know how to decode. So, and at the end of my lecture, I will try to decode this code. So something is written there in the genome, in the regulatory part of genome, which is pretty big. For instance, if you look at this nice picture of a butterfly and this guy who is actually ancestor of butterfly, both of them actually carry the same genome, but you see how beautiful can be something which is encoded in the same genome. Or for instance, these two fishes, they carry the same genome in their busha, but if this fish is in sea, it looks like very nice fish, but when it's in river, it looks like a very bad fish. So, and also in the morphology and behavior. And this is the same genome. Actually, in the fish, there can go up to four different forms encoded by the same genome, and all of these forms are actually mature, sexually mature forms. So a lot of things encoded in the regulatory genome, and maybe in our genome, some monsters are also encoded, actually, as it, in this very nice novel of Dr. Jail and Mr. Hyde, when in the day there is a nice person, in the night it gets into the very big monster, which is encoded in the same genome. And that reminds me kind of a state of a disease. So maybe a disease is a different state of our genome, which is encoded there, but we don't know how. So basically, if you look at the units, which are actually units of the regulatory code, of course, we can talk, we should talk about transcription factors and their binding sites. So here's an example of one transcription factor called AP1, which is here in red, which is a small protein which in which is a nucleus binds into to their binding sites, to the place in genome, and this is the initial event of any regulation of the gene. So, and usually those binding sites are located in so-called promoter regions of genes in front of the start of transcriptions. Some of them are in introns, in enhancers, but basically we can build such a standard view on a promoter or enhancer. This is a kind of organized structure of binding sites in the promoter, which regulate the genes. And we know not all of the binding sites. We have to find them experimentally or with a computer. So computationally, we actually are able to find them by so-called positional weight matrices or consensi, which shows the most frequent nucleotides in each position of the binding site of a given transcription factor, for instance, AP1. Those binding sites were collected for a long time in transfoc, and now we have a big collection of those matrices, which can be now applied to any promoter region or any region of genome, where we can, with a very simple mathematics, basically find where this matrix fit to the sequence in the promoter and predict transcription factor binding sites. Sounds easy, but the problem is, the first problem here, so it will be many problems in my talk, not in the talk, but I will talk about the problems. Actually, if you look at the AP1 transcription factor, the consensus of this factor, of these binding sites for this factor is pretty short. And of course, the binding sites, real binding sites, which coincide with the consensus, there are a number of them. For instance, binding site here in this gene, there is an experimentally proven binding sites, which actually fully coincide with the consensus. Although majority of sites are a little bit different from the consensus. For instance, this site in mouse interleukin 2 gene and this position has two variances if compared to the consensus. It's fine so far. But the problem is that there are sites, real true sites, where the AP1 is binding, which are completely different from consensus. This one, for instance, which is located nearby, is just four nucleotides different from seven. So it's more different than similar. And but this is actually a real site. And if we want to find it, we have to apply our tools to search for the binding sites with a very low cutoff. And then we get pictures like that. So this is one promoter of mouse C4's gene, where here is start of transcription, and here is a sequence of the promoter upstream, like 100 nucleotides. And each line here is one prediction, is a prediction of potential binding sites for some transcription factor from our library. And you see, it's not just the one binding site which is predicted here, but it's a number of alternative variants of different binding sites which can be predicted here. So the question is what it is. Is it artifact of the program which search for the binding sites, or it's a true fact? So looking at this, we were searching, of course, for the known examples, and there are examples in literature showing that indeed, the same region of promoter can be occupied by different transcription factors. This is experimentally proven facts in different cell types. For instance, this promoter of this human TNF alpha, this place of the promoter is occupied by NFAT transcription factor with combination with AP1, NF kappa B, CABP, different factors can bind to the same place. And interestingly, the same place is bound by a repressor in other types of cells, vitamin D receptor. So is it this place is so important? So that's occupied by so many factors, or it's a standard situation? When we look at ChIP-seq experiments, then we see actually this situation. For instance, this is a result of one experiment when one cell line, cancer cell line, was ChIP-seq'd by many transcription factors. So actually around 600 different transcription factors was used to do the ChIP-seq experiment. And here each line is one transcription factor, and these are the true ChIP-seq results. So the real in vivo binding. And you see here in this near this position, which actually a position of one SNP in the super enhancer controlling expression of MYC gene as occupied in that cell line by many factors. So this is actually experimentally proven fact that binding sites for transcription factors are actually overlapping or even putting in the same place. So which is completely different from our main concept of genetic code, when the basic concept of genetic code was that codons not overlap. Here I can I'll be proud to say the first law of regulatory code is that codons can overlap. Then actually, if we look at transcription factor binding, we can see that we should forget about this accepted concept about exact fit of an enzyme fits to their substrate. In this case, when transcription factors binding to DNA, we should talk about weak binding. And to confirm that, there are many experiments also on the physical level, but also on computational level, we can compare the binding sites for different organisms to each other. And in this nice paper, authors published that when they compare the lengths of the binding site, which actually in fact coincide with the affinity of this factor to this place in DNA, is different between different factors. And what is interesting, in bacteria, they're generally longer and more exact than in yeast or in multicellular eukaryotes. So here we see information content of the binding site, which actually tells you how long is the site and how conservative, how certain it is. And in the eukaryote, in multicellular eukaryotes, actually the sites are almost twice as shorter and less informative as in bacteria. And the shocking fact is actually, if you need a transcription factor to be binding to its site exactly in one site, exactly in one genome, then you have to actually, in a certain simple calculation, you can see that information content, say in bacteria, of the binding sites is above the information content you need in the bacteria to find its own site. But in eukaryote, since the genome is longer, the information content which you need to find your site is has to be higher, but in fact is much, much, much more lower. So this paradox is still to be explained. And indeed, if we compare simply visually, the transcription factors from E. coli, for example, this lac repressor, and the transcription factors from eukaryotes like AP1, then we see that simply this gigantic factor finding their binding sites and actually turning around the DNA is much bigger and much more effective than these small and tiny transcription factors in eukaryotes. And people talking now about so-called the soft touch. So when the transcription factors are binding to their binding sites, they should not be highly affine. Because this low affinity in this model, in this nice paper, they demonstrated that when there are sites with low affinity, they can really play a role in fine-tuning the expression patterns. Because if there is a high affinity site, it will attract a lot of factors and any fine tuning will be destroyed. So that's a very simple actually consideration. And so the second law which we want to roll out is that sites are uncertain. So the big weak binding and its uncertainty goes especially true for eukaryotic organisms. And the next thing is, since this binding is so uncertain, we can see that there are a number of facts that transcription factors actually binding not alone. They cooperate with each other, and that was demonstrated and started to collect in a database called Compel by Olga Kilmargulis, who is with us today. We found actually a lot of examples when various transcription factors binding to their neighboring sites and cooperate with each other. And with that, they actually help each other to bind low affine sites. And this leads to synergistic effect. In fact, such cooperative binding is observed even more complex. For instance, in this case of interferon beta enhanceosome, we talk about four transcription factors which has to be activated altogether and bind to their cognate place, which we call composite module. So the third law of the regulatory code, sites work in combinations. So we call them composite models. So finally, we can unify it in a concept, we call it fuzzy puzzle, which is actually nicely drawn here by Daria Stelmashenko. In fact, it's like a game of a children game. You know the puzzle when different pieces of the puzzle has to put together to get one picture. Here we talk about actually fuzzy puzzle. So the puzzle which has pictures which have units which doesn't fit to each other well. So actually with such units you can construct not just one picture but several different pictures, and these pictures can play a different role. For instance, if these guys came together, bind to the DNA, the gene is activated. If someone kicked out and another is coming here, and the same DNA, actually, they recognize different places and then the gene is repressed. So in fact, this sounds strange, but this, this mechanism is experimentally now proven. The people call it phase separation model. It's a nice work from the lab of Richard Young from MIT, where they talk about a so-called phase separation process. So if you have a liquid of different properties, for example, water and the oil, then the oil units, they after shaking, they got into so-called concentrates, little bubbles which concentrate them with each other. And they, in Richard Young lab, they found this even with a microscope, they actually see those concentrates of a transcription factors which come together suddenly like these droplets of this oil, and then they start regulate transcription. You see, it's quite a complicated process. And this whole concept is pretty bizarre, but we hope it actually very useful. According to this saying, a good theory is the one which is the most practical thing. So that's why we try to take this concept and make a good thing out of it, which would help us to understand how mutations in regulatory regions, for instance, can lead to a disease. So, and in that way, we came up with a model, mathematical model of a composite module, which can be in a promoter region or in any enhancer region of genome. And this module have a certain length, which we don't know how big should it be. And this module contains several binding sites for several transcription factors, which we don't know in advance. And actually those sites could stay in a certain positions to each other or orientation, because the factors which are binding to them, they have to cooperate. Again, we don't know that. So, but we let an artificial intelligence, in this case, a genetic algorithm, help us to find out that combinations automatically. And for this algorithm works in the following way. Basically, it iterates different models of this combination of binding sites with different parameters. And it finds such a model which discriminate promoters or enhancers of our focus from the background sequences in genome. So the red bars from the blue bars. And this algorithm worked for some time and find such a model which discriminate these two distributions best. So for instance, we made an experiment. We took a set of promoters of genes which are regulated in the same way in cell cycle. So there is a set of genes which actually started to express in the point of transition from S phase to G1. So when we took these promoters and analyzed them all together, we clearly discriminate those promoters from other promoters in genome. And we found out, the algorithm actually found out that there is a combination of binding sites, which include P2F factors, Tata box, CRAP, SP1, and others, which often happens together in these promoters of the cell cycle regulated genes. And now we can apply this knowledge to this bizarre picture we observed in the very beginning. So in this promoter of CFOS gene, we see in this yellow region from here to here, you see E2F site, Tata box, CRAP, SP1. So 4 out of 5 binding sites found together in this small region. And that tells us that this promoter must be regulated also in cell cycle manner, which was then later confirmed experimentally. And of course, we want to make this even helpful for many users, people. So we made a so-called GeneXplain platform. We have another story about that. And here you have a button, genetic variants, where you can click and run such an algorithm for yourself. And it will, for instance, you put there all regions which have a particular mutation or SNP associated to a disease, and then the algorithm will find a combination of binding sites and also those binding sites which actually located and that exactly at that place and also in the sites which are around, which discriminate those regions from the other regions in genome. Okay, so, and then actually we get further and said, why should we do this work manually? Why not giving to artificial intelligence the complete thing? So just put there the data, press one button and get at the end the drugs which you have to give therapies to the patient. So we created this tool called Genome Enhancer, and it uses this concept of fuzzy puzzle to understand our diseases. And I come now to the second part of my talk, showing some examples. First example come from the cancer domain. So there's many problems with cancer. Cancer is a dragon with many heads, but one of the head which we have to chop off is actually the problem of a wrong drug. So we have a patient and we give him a drug, but it may be a wrong drug for this particular patient. We have to find the right drug. And there are tools, of course, now which help to do that on a genomic level. So you take sample from the tumor of the patient, and there are companies like Caris or Foundation One or many others, which actually sequence that sample using a targeted set of genes and find the mutations which are known to be associated with a particular treatment. So there is already knowledge in a database. If this mutation happens, then you have to give this pill to that person. But the problem is there are still too few mutations which are known. And many times this, like in this case, there is a real case of one person with a colorectal cancer when such analysis returned just very poor results. Like it says, okay, there is one mutation in KRAS gene, which tells about lack of benefits of applying these medicaments, which is already quite well, but it doesn't find anything else which would tell us which drug has actually have to be used. But many of those mutations which they found are actually located in regulatory regions of different genes. And now we can put them in our genome enhancer and ask a question, can we actually give a recommendation about a certain drug treatment to this patient based on regulatory mutations? And when we first map them into the genome, you see that mutations are mapped in many genes, and here they are shown in red bars. And most of them are actually located in introns or 3' or 5' regions of those genes, and usually any two actually ignores them. Here we want to understand what they can do, and actually, as it's shown on this picture, one mutation, like this known mutation in that position of that gene, already known, documented, it actually lead to diabetes. And what happens when A changed to C, this binding site for the factor CoA is actually lost. So, and this gene is not regulated by this factor any longer. So this leads to the disease. Another case, when one mutation actually can gain the site, so the sites appear, which was not there before. The same mutation can actually kill the site and create the site at the same time, like in this example. So we try to look at those mutations in that patient and try to understand which of them actually create or lost the site. And we use again this MATCH algorithm from our transfoc, when we actually now ask a question, if there is a mutation happens here, for instance, this T is changed to G, we can of course calculate the score of that new binding site with this mutation. And if this score is dramatically lower than the previous score, we can say this site actually is lost. And other way around, if this new score is higher than the previous score, we can say the site is actually gained. And we can do this exercise actually extensively for all these mutations which are observed in that person, in that tumor sample. And for instance, this is a result of that search. And here is a list of transcription factors, basically their binding, their matrices, their weight matrices, which are frequently lost or gained by due to those mutations. For instance, this one, NRSE, which is a binding site for a factor called REST, is very often lost. 95 mutations which are observed in this patient actually kill these sites, and the p-value of that is very low. So actually, this is, as I said, the transcription factor REST, which is depicted here. This is a big thing which is binding to DNA in the, and represses the genes. And when it's lost, this gene can be derepressed. And of course, that's interesting mechanism. And we took those mutations, all of them actually, and ran our algorithm and, searching for a combination of binding sites around those mutated binding sites. And we found actually many interesting facts. First, this combination indeed includes the REST binding sites. So that one of the part of the found composite module. And the second very interesting genes, like EGFR gene, carries these composite modules near their mutations. And this little arrow here indicates this REST binding site. So if you look at them more closer, this is this position, which is in fact an exon of that gene. And this it's actually a synonymous mutation. It doesn't change the protein, but it can change this transcription factor binding site. You see this C is changed to T, and the whole binding site disappears. So the score of that site gets dramatically low. And if you lost this site, the other factors which are around can bind, perhaps, this is our assumption, and then it can, this repression of that gene can actually dramatically change. So this gene can be activated. And so, we also know from the literature that this particular SNP is already known to be related with the risk of primary lung cancer or risk to head and neck squamous cell carcinoma. So it's important SNP. And here we try to start to understanding how it works. The next question is actually, those transcription factors got activated. But now we want to repress them. If we want to try to treat the disease, we want to find a master regulator and any molecule in the cell which can control the activity of that factors. And maybe and then we can find drugs which can inhibit these master regulators. And actually a bit further, but that's a whole new story, which we find time maybe next time to talk about. But basically in the normal cells, there these canonical pathways works, but in the cancer cells, we have to forget about canonical pathways. There's a complete rewiring of the network. And the very important part, feature of them is actually a multiple feedback loops, which appears there when the master regulator, the new one, actually start to control expression of the genes, including the gene which encode itself and also other components of the whole signaling pathway. It start working on itself. We led our genetic algorithm, our artificial intelligence, to find this network, which has this master regulator, which have these feedback loops. It's a very complicated network, and that's only part of it, which this algorithm shows. And you see this EGF receptor and EGF itself complex was found by the algorithm as one of the master regulator, which leads to the activity of those genes itself. But actually, it's pretty complicated network and difficult to understand, but we let genetic algorithm to work to do the understanding as well, although it also create for us a simplified version of that, since we need something to show. But in reality, it worked with a complex network, and then it looked for those drugs which can bind to those master regulators, and it prioritizes those drugs and actually tells which ones have more priority to be applied for this patient. And in this case, it found, for instance, this inhibitor of many kinases, regorafenib and other ones, but this is at the top, which in fact has the biggest priority from the point of view of this artificial intelligence. So, in case of that patient, it was our recommendation to treat that patient, and then the doctors actually started doing it. This algorithm, in fact, can predict also some repurposing drugs, but that's again another story. Now we want to talk about COVID-19. Why? Well, because it's so important, but actually also it looks like it's the same mechanism here. So everybody talks about cytokine storm, which is observed in a severe patient of COVID-19. And the cytokine storm is in fact also kind of feedback loop. So when there is an initial number of interleukin 6, for instance, in the beginning, they trigger activity of T cells, which actually expresses other interleukins, which in turn gets into expression of and the original interleukins, and you get into these feedback loops, which goes like a fire. Any inflammation is like a fire. You need just one first trigger, and then fire goes on automatically. So to understand the mechanism of this fire, we look at the data coming from big GWAS studies of patients which have COVID-19 susceptibility. And this is a famous picture from that experiment. They got more than 3,000 patients of COVID-19, which are hospitalized. So, namely, they got quite severe disease. And they took a genotype of those patients and compared it with a regular population. And they found two peaks, one in chromosome 3 and in chromosome 21. Which of the SNPs, which are significantly associated with this risk or to be hospitalized, of risk of actually of severe disease. There's this famous paper from Svante Pabula, actually in Nature, when they studied this first peak, and they found that actually it contains a smaller sub-peak here nearby with a highest association, including, for instance, this one SNP, which alone gives approximately 1.7 times higher risk of hospitalization for this patient. And it's located in a 3' area of this gene. this gene is very strange. Actually, it expresses in so-called cilium. It's little hairs in on the surface of cells, which are expressed in lung and other tissues. And the thing is that this genotype came from inherited from Neanderthals. That was very interesting fact in this paper. I don't know why actually that was inherited, but still the clear fact that this gene plays some role, but for us is important to understand how it is regulated. And we looked more carefully at those SNPs, and this is a region of which was found by Svante Pebele, which is located in the 3' area of that gene. And these are all SNPs in that area which are associated with this severe disease. And if you look at them more carefully in that region and look which binding sites can be affected by this SNP, we can see that this first SNP, this one which was the biggest association, actually can create IRF3 sites, and it can kill vitamin DR sites. And this creation of that very high affinity binding sites for IRF, and IRF is actually interferon response factor, which is definitely playing a role in a severe disease. But actually the most interesting was to look at another SNP, which is located nearby. And here we observed that this SNP actually creates a glucocorticoid site, glucocorticoid receptor binding site. So you see this, when the A is a reference genome, and then when it's changed to G, then this site is created and the score of that site is pretty high. So we were asking question, why is this glucocorticoid receptor is so important? But the answer to that question came from another study we did on gene expression data, which we got from published study when gene expression changes were scanned, profiled in severe COVID-19 patients. We took two patients and we ran it through our system, and the system gave recommendation of drugs for treating these patients. But and then we'll talk about this later, but actually the first thing we observe, this gene is actually upregulated in the patient number one. And we also observe that this gene, the promoter of that gene has a combination of binding sites, including glucocorticoid receptor binding site, which drive this gene activity of that gene. So in the intron and 3' region of that gene, we also see SNPs which affect the glucocorticoid binding site. So it seems it has something to do with activity of that gene. We don't know the role of that gene, but what this artificial intelligence tells us that all other genes, including this one, are controlled by this set of transcription factors, which are in turn are controlled by these interleukins like interleukin 1 and TNF alpha. And this feedback loop is actually triggered initially, perhaps by some initial events, but then it's get into this fire of repeating activation, and then taking these all master regulators, now we can this program tells us which drugs can be applied for this particular patient. So the TNF inhibitor etanercept, or VEGF inhibitor, and interleukin 1 inhibitor, anakinra, or actually glucocorticoid receptor, protein which are triggered by a drug called prednisolone. And when we look on the internet, we find actually evidences that indeed these drugs are already used in treating COVID-19 patients. This TNF alpha inhibitor, for instance, shown to be effective. Also, as for bevacizumab, it's actually currently going on three clinical trials against the COVID-19, disease. And anakinra is also shown to be effective in sepsis, and now it's also can be used for the COVID-19. As for the prednisolone, actually, it's interesting that dexamethasone, another drug which is pretty similar to this one, is already FDA approved, and also there is a literature saying that prednisolone can be used as well. So these findings are having sense. But now coming to the next final conclusion of my talk, let's check what we learned so far. So we learned that promoters don't exist. So indeed, so that standard structure of a very organized promoter where we have data box and other boxes, we forget about that. So we see that a promoter may be really bizarre, is occupying a lot of sites on it. Sites don't actually exist. So sites are very weak. So the same factor can bind many places. The same site can be occupied by many factors. Pictures actually disappear. We talk about a little bit about pathways. The canonical pathways in disease really don't exist. There is a severe rewiring of pathways, which we should consider. So things are really getting very complicated. But the question is why? How in evolution that happens? And to answer that question, I put this analogy to surrealism. You see this is a genome, and something grows out of genome, of this gray matter of genome. And this idea of analogy comes from looking at the paintings and in historical manner. So when I was going through the corridors of museum, starting from early paintings and then going through the history of art, suddenly I realized that actually the picture gets disappeared. So it's getting less and less stuff on it. So basically no less and less points we can see on the picture in course of time. For instance, here, just, 5 points. And of course, this virtual tour ends by the black square of Malevich, who said this is the final point in the whole history of art. So now, when I put these old paintings in the zip archive, I realized that actually the size of the file dramatically drops over time. And ZIP is actually measuring complexity. So complexity of the paintings getting down. So I also look then actually interesting that complexity of binding sites in evolution from bacteria to human, it also goes down. So it started from these big and certain binding sites, it goes shorter and more uncertain and it's more or less disappeared. We are talking about that sites actually don't exist. And the fact, so in complexity in time is decreasing in evolutional time. Why? That's a question. And actually I thought that maybe our perspective is not complete. When we look at the particular painting or particular part of a system, we forget about the observer. And you see again this guy. So if you take a Neanderthal person looking at this painting, he probably see nothing or he get angry. But if you take people like this who has prior knowledge about all this history of art and everything, they see a lot in that painting, and actually and the observer becomes more complex. So you have to consider the whole system together. An interesting thing that these people can actually see different passages in the same painting. And these two people can see completely different messages. So the whole system evolve together. So the paintings, the DNA binding sites getting simpler, but the structure of regulation, the whole transcriptional machinery becomes more and more complex. And the whole system together getting really complex. So this regulatory code, now let's try to read what is here from that perspective, what we understand about regulatory code. So basically, if you take this message, and now we can read it differently depending on the cellular context. For instance, you can Under certain context, you can see here, hello, Alexander, at the beginning of our talk. Under different contexts, at the end of the talk, you can read from the same text, actually, goodbye, Alexander. And as you can see, this letter or, say, binding site for a certain transcription factor is reused, but here it's kind of activation, and here is kind of repression. You can see here many other messages. For instance, I don't know, run Alexander fast if you sing I do not very well. And actually you can read here many other messages. For instance, you can read here message Germany. So probably this message was never written there intentionally, but under certain conditions, you can read it. And if you allow a certain mistakes there in reading, you can even read something like Russia, which was definitely not intended to be written there. But if you change R to S, you can find this message. And you can find more and more messages encoded here, depending on the context. And actually, the more closer this message to the random, the more messages you can find there. So basically, this regulatory code solves the problem of evolution. Evolution wants to be, in quotation mark, quotation mark, to be free from limitations. And here, due to the multiplicity of regulatory messages encrypted in the non-coding part of genome, now practically any mutation can lead to a new regulation. So it's quickly changing the regulation because a lot of messages are written there. So basically, in our genome, many monsters are hidden, those disease-specific enhancers, but it seems those monsters were not specifically put there, intentionally put there, so they may appear by chance due to large regulatory capacity of genome, and that's due, actually, that regulatory genome that is almost free from evolutional limitations. So since there are some patterns, but maybe if we wait another billion years of evolution, it will be completely random. So it's not yet fully free. And if you talk about freedom, actually, and the surrealism, in fact, Andrew Breton, who was in the beginning of surrealistic movement, he was telling that the only thing that can inspire me in the world is the word freedom. And in case of genome, the surrealism of genome is in its pursuit to freedom. But as you know, for freedom, you have to pay, as always. And we pay by diseases. So at the end, to summarize my talk, I can tell that in the principles of regulatory code, we are talking about sites that are overlapping, that they're weak, and they work in composite. Actually, we talk about fuzzy puzzle. We apply this concept to application example and several of them, and we see there are many diseases that work as with the feedback loops, but artificial intelligence can help us to find actionable mutation and right drugs. And at the end, with the evolutional concept and surrealism genome, we see that freedom to evolve towards high coding capacity is the intention, but diseases is our price to pay. So with that, I want to finish, and I'm open for questions. Thank you very much.
Alexander, thank you very much for your great presentation. It was very, very interesting. And now let's see what questions do we have. So we do have a couple of questions. Let's start with this one. How do you see the future of enhancer analysis and RNA specifically in medical genetics?
Yes, thank you for this question. I see that it will be a tremendous role of it. So many diseases actually have a lot of regulatory, role in their pursuit. Basically, cancer, infection, inflammation, so many complex diseases, almost all complex diseases we study, they have a big part of it included in the regulatory potential of the genome. So analysis of enhancers is very important indeed in understanding the medical mechanisms of the disease, in finding the master regulators, in finding those pathways which activated in disease, and finally to find therapies. But not only, actually very important to find biomarkers which would tell us what kind of therapy or what kind of disease progression or which biomarkers which would help us to find early sign of the disease. All these kind of things can be done with the help of analysis of regulatory regions of genomes.
Yeah, thank you very much. So one more question. Someone is telling many thanks for your presentation, and how do you think about precise identification of TSS with methods like CAGE? When we applied such methods and we can precisely identify this, does it help probably in the to increase efficiency of integration of TSS and promoters in general analysis?
Absolutely. Absolutely. And actually in our system, we use Phantom 5. That's tremendous efforts of mapping, starts of transcription in many different tissues in human and also in mouse. And that's of tremendous importance because actually the position of starting of transcription where the most part of regulation is actually concentrated in a particular situation, a particular tissue is very important to know. Because if we have just a list of differentially expressed genes and nothing else, what we do, we take position of promoter from ensemble, so the bigger, the most frequent one. And in that case, we might be actually in, 40% of the cases are simply wrong. We are looking in the wrong place. Because in that particular situation, in that disease, this gene started from a different place. And it would be important exactly to know from where. And as I said, Phantom 5 helped us to get the position of TSS in if we know in which tissue we study. And we give a tissue and we take the right position for each gene. But the problem is often in case of diseases, say in cancer, we don't know exactly. And it would be very helpful to get some resources which would increase capacity of different situations where a start of transcription can be observed. Yes, indeed, it's very helpful.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. And so far we do not have further questions. Maybe right now, so people are just thinking what exactly to ask about. Please feel free to send us your questions via emails, support@genexplain.com or info@genexplain.com. And I would like to thank everyone of participants of today, and many thanks to Alexander again for this great presentation. And have a good day or good evening, good morning, everyone. Please join our next web seminars. Goodbye.
Thank you very much. Goodbye.